I know from very sit. We have Evangelist Trevor Francis, but Minister Clinton will give him his very own special welcome. Are there any first-time visitors sitting with us, worshiping with us today? If you are, please stand and give your name. Okay, I don't see anyone. No first-time visitors? Okay, in that case, I want to once again welcome. Oh, there's one visitor there, somebody who's shy. Pardon me? Carl. 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 As I said, I don't have the information in terms of address or church affiliation, but I still want to take this time out to welcome you. And thank you for choosing Ruby to worship with us here this morning. And as usual, we here at Ruby like to give you a special welcome. You can give her a special Ruby welcome. I also want to take this time to extend thanks from Brother Orson, who's here with us. Brother Orson, it's good to have you back with us. Brother Orson himself said he wants to thank the church, the entire church family, for lifting him up in prayer during his time of his, I don't know if I want to call it infirmity, but we know our God is a healer. And our God is a promise keeper. And if we praise God, as we should, he will look after us. We are supposed, even now with all that is happening now, actually, when things are not going the way they're supposed to be going, that's when we really should be praising God. Amen. That's when we really demonstrate, you know, that we are definitely children of God. Amen? Amen. Amen. All right, Sister Angela Belgrim and her team will come back now and give us and take us in song.
Pressing on in faith. Pressing on in faith. That's our theme for this morning. Hallelujah. The Apostle Paul said, forgetting what is behind and striving to what, for what is ahead. He pressed towards the goal for the price, to win the price for which God has called him heavenward in Jesus Christ. And this morning, God wants us to press on, church. Despite whatever is going on, God wants us to press on. Forget about the past. Even forget about yourselves and just press on in faith. He's coming soon. He's coming soon. And we have to hold the fort here as Christians until he comes. Praise the Lord. Hold the fort. I don't know if most persons remember this nice old hymn. Let's sing and stand up, sing and praise God this morning. Hold the fort.
Oh,
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And we are persuaded, hallelujah, that he is able to keep that. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We should be committed unto him against that day.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I know whom I have believed. Praise the Lord.
Oh, but I know I believe it.
Press on in faith.
Amen.
Press on in faith. Hallelujah. What a day it will be. Hallelujah. When my Jesus, I shall see. When I look upon his face.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand. Hallelujah. What a day. A glorious day. It will be. Hallelujah.
When he takes me by the hand. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. What a day. That will be where we want to see him.
Hallelujah.
Look upon his face. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Where we want to see him. Look upon his face. There to sing forever of his saving grace. Church, are you excited?
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Are you looking forward to that day? Give God some praise.
Hallelujah.
Give God
Hallelujah.
Some praise. You say Hallelujah. Yes and you say Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. But you don't seem to be looking forward to that glorious, wonderful
yes.
day.
Thank
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Oh, Hallelujah. I want to see him. To look upon his face
oh,
and there to sing forever and ever and ever
Hallelujah.
And ever
Hallelujah.
Of his saving grace
Thank you,
on the streets
of glory.
Of glory.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh, hallelujah. Let
hallelujah.
Me lift my voice. Here's all past. Home at last.
Yes.
Ever and ever,
ever.
And ever to rejoice. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Oh, you want to see him. Oh, praise the Lord.
Oh.
move on, I just want to share a poem with you. It is called The Race. And we all know that we are in a race. Hallelujah. And we all know what our price is and what our goal is. Hallelujah. And we just need to keep pressing on in faith. Praise the Lord. This race we have entered is not for the weak, not for personal glory, nor for attention to seek. This race we have entered unqualified. We were chosen. No more walking in darkness. For the price now, we must run. In faith, we have set off. We have started this race. We have a long way to go, so we need to pick up the pace. Never mind you have pushed off a little after the gun, and others seem halfway before you've even begun. Never mind the distance they may seem ahead. It's not a competition. By God's Spirit be led. There are no records to break, no best times to be recorded. You may have started off slow. At least you have started. No steroids to maintain a good steady pace or to disqualify you, putting you out of the race. No cheering from the sideline to push you along. This race is not for the physically fit, but for the spiritually strong. Be prepared for the challenge. It will sometimes be hard. Run in confidence. Run in the word. Run with boldness, with courage, in spite of the pain. If you fall down, get up and start running again. Run with purpose. Be focused. Stay on track. Don't make the mistake of ever turning back. Run with love and assurance. Encourage a sister or a brother. This is a race we can all run together. Run knowing you're closer to the end now than to the start. Enjoy the opposition. Don't grow weary and lose heart. Look to the finish and don't stop on the way. There's a victory to be won, a prize waiting there. So don't dwell on the race, how arduous and long. Hold on to your faith and finish strong. Soon and very soon, the King we will see. Oh, what a joy on finishing this race it will be. Thank you.
This race is a race that we all need to finish. The good thing about this race is that, I mean, the race could be for anyone. Anyone can get into this race. No matter what level your fitness is, you can get into this race. And everyone that finishes is guaranteed goal. Guaranteed goal. Amen? Amen. At this time, we will have our tithes and offerings. The ushers will get in place. Everyone knows the protocol by now. And the tech team will play an offertory, Build Your Church by Elevation Worship. The tech team will play an offertory.
Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for allowing us another day to come and worship with you, that we can receive from you, and in turn, that we can give back to you a portion of what you have given to us. We ask you, dear Lord, that you will bless each and every one of us, and you will bless the hands who have to use this offering to further your kingdom. We ask this in Jesus' name, amen.
God's word, and it's taken from 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1 through to verse 8. Reading. I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of the ministry. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Here ends the word, in the reading of God's word. Soon and very soon, we're going to see the King. Soon and very soon. As we sing this song before the preach word, I want to encourage you this morning to prepare your hearts and prepare your minds for the word that God is going to send unto us today. But most of all, I want to encourage you to keep holding on and keep pressing on in faith. Don't be distracted. There's so many things happening to distract us. Left, right, center. Even the occurrences this morning with the lightning and the equipment here at church. But we got to be focused. Amen. Because if we ever take our eyes off the price, if we ever run the race and look to the left and right, hallelujah, and we don't keep focus on Christ, it would be for naught. Hallelujah. Soon and very soon, we're going to see the King. Hallelujah.
We are going to see the King. Message will be brought to us by evangelist Trevor Francis. For those who do not know Brother Francis, he's hailing from the parish of St. Andrew. He's a member of the Hillaby Church of the Nazarene, a former secondary school teacher, one who had broken the word through this island, and even further abroad in several of the Caribbean countries. And for those of us here at Ruby, he's no stranger. Those of you whose memories are still with you, and those new members might not would have heard him, but I can tell you that he's one who rightly divides the word of God with fervor and under the anointing of the Spirit. So, this morning, I want you to welcome evangelist Trevor Francis to our platform as he comes to break the word of God. Brother Francis, welcome.
Thank you,
morning. Grace be unto you. Peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Please turn your Bibles to the book of St. Matthew. Chapter 6. God often calls on us to do some very difficult things while we are pressing forward in faith. Text this morning speaks of one of those things. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 12. And forgive us our debts, as we have forgiven our debtors. That scripture is also found in the book of Luke, 11th chapter, and the 4th verse. You may not end up seeing the king. Let me say we may not end up seeing the king if we persist in unforgiveness. Father, we thank you for your patience with us. We thank you for your long suffering. We thank you that you looked upon us as sinners in Adam's loins long before we were brought into this world and made provision for our forgiveness by sending your son Jesus to die on the cross of Calvary. As your word says, he who knew no sin became a sin offering for us. And on top of that, begged you to forgive those who manhandled him because they didn't know what they were doing. I simply pray this morning that your people would hear you talking to them instead of a guy from Hillaby St. Thomas named Trevor Francis. For it is possible to come into your house and hear a preacher and not hear you. Help us to hear you. And we very well know when we hear you because we change. When we don't hear you, we don't change. So help us. In Jesus' name. No preacher likes preaching on these subjects, you know. This petition that is in front of us in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 12 makes me very uncomfortable. As a young Christian, I used to read certain scriptures, but Lord saved me in 1970. And as a young Christian, there were some portions of scripture that I desperately wish that I could cut them out in the Bible and put them somewhere far so you don't have to see them. This is one. It's another one in Romans chapter 8, which says, "For we know that all things, Andrew, all things." As a young Christian, I used to say all the time, can be all things. "Work together for good to those who love the Lord, even to those who are the called according to his purpose." Until later on, with the help of mature Christians and other people who had my best interest at heart, I was able to see that it boils down to this. There's a condition on that verse. It doesn't work for good for everybody. It is to those who love the Lord and to those who are the called according to his purpose. So the questions always remain, do I love the Lord? I'm not always sure. I know he loves me, but I'm not sure that I love him sometimes. Do I love the Lord? You can answer yes. Am I one of the called according to his purpose? Well then, if you answer in the affirmative to those questions, scripture is telling us that all things, COVID, will work together for good to those who love the Lord. Well, I know a lot of Christians don't believe what I just said. I've heard, gone in churches recently, I heard people demanding that God make it move. And they don't seem to realize that they are not in any position to do that, because God is not obligated to anybody. There's a, this petition in front of us is one that we like to sidestep. We like to dodge it and overlook it. But the Holy Spirit will not let us overlook or sidestep this scripture, as it is written here and in other places. Why doesn't he do that? Because unforgiveness in the Christian's life is an attitude which the Holy Spirit cannot accept. Why? Because the body of Christ cannot survive without forgiveness. How so? Because by forgiveness we found favor with God. And by this same forgiveness we maintain fellowship with God. So an unforgiven spirit is the very foundation of Christian community, fellowshipping with each other. Forgiveness is a powerful weapon against unforgiveness. With it, we can enjoy harmony with God's people. Without it, the storm continues. Everyone knew what caused the tension in the congregation. I don't mean this one. Two elderly church members had a conflict, and the brethren had divided their loyalties between the two of them. This made any kind of progress impossible in the congregation. There were two camps. And these two camps, Sunday after Sunday, blatantly, they sat under preaching. But they sat under preaching hardened by the same preaching. You can sit under preaching and be hardened by that preaching. It's a terrible state to be in. So these two camps, church split down the middle. Mind you, you see, you start looking a little bit already. I ain't talking about Ruby, understand? Split down the middle. And these camps are sitting under several weeks of teaching pastor see what's happening, and he's trying his best, and the Spirit is prompting him to preach on forgiveness, but they ain't moving, they ain't budging. The standoff continued. And after much prayer, the pastor was led by the Spirit to take action. So during a morning service like this one, he called on the two men to stand and then ask them to forgive each other in the morning service. For the pastor knew that if peace were ever to reign again in the congregation, confrontation had to occur. We don't like confrontation either, you know? But there is such a thing as confrontation without condemnation. You can confront without condemning. That was a good place to say amen. You ask me where I get it from. I got it from Jesus. He confronted the woman caught in the act of adultery, but he did not condemn her. He actually said so. Neither do I condemn you. He confronted her though. Some of us are scared to confront each other in our family situations. And in our church situations, we don't want ruffling the feathers, we don't want nobody getting vexed with we and all that type of thing. And it caused a whole upheaval that day. For the life of me, I can't understand how these guys caught this woman in the very act. Bless my soul. Means so, just so? They set her up, man. It was a setup. You caught in the very act, brought her to Jesus, misinterpreted scripture, because the Old Testament said all two of them should be stoned, all two of them. It says so in Leviticus. They not only set up the woman, they set up Jesus too. Thought Jesus would, look, If we want to fool Jesus, we got to get real early. He's always one step ahead. He said, Master, we caught this woman in the very act. And Moses in the law said, she should be stoned. That's not what Moses said. Moses said all two of them should be stoned. So what you say? And Jesus, knowing who he was, knowing he had come from God, knowing the job that he had to do, which included forgiveness, he probably said to himself, look, guys, look, I never asked for this job, you see. I am here to, first of all, you interrupt my meeting and bring this woman in here. I never asked for it, but you have handed me this assignment, and this is how we're going to do it. If there's anybody out there among you who is sinless, meaning qualifying to that sinlessness as I am, you come here with me and we're going to stone her. Jesus did not just mean if there was anybody out there who had not committed adultery. There was a guy in that congregation, if he was there, would have raised his hand and said, I have never committed adultery, talking about the rich young ruler. Because he looked Jesus in the eye and said, I have not committed adultery. So if he was there, a hand would have gone up. Jesus did not mean, is there anybody there who has not committed adultery? No, 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 no. He meant, is there anybody there who is sinless as I am? You come up here with a stoner. So you know what happened? You see how all them left? And as they left there, the hands of their hearts were still clutching the stones to use on another occasion. You think they're easy? Oh, you think I'm trying to entertain you? Pastor called on these two men to forgive each other. And there was a standoff. The two men faced off. Pause. And the Holy Spirit would have had to speak to both their hearts at the same time. Because both their hands went out simultaneously. And they moved toward each other with no hidden agendas. And embrace. But thank God it wasn't COVID then. But COVID or no COVID, the Holy Spirit must have bring them together. And 45 minutes later, the crying and forgiving throughout the congregation finally stopped. The church was revitalized to serve together as the loving community for the glory of God. Forgiveness is not foolishness. It is seeing the offender through God's eyes. Because everyone runs the risk of being hurt. All of us have suffered at the hands of another. We struggle with forgiveness. Some of us vow never to forgive. Some of us go as far as to sin over our dead body because we see it as a weakness. In other places, it is called the Queen of Virtues, but it is not easy in the flesh nor on the flesh. When Nelson Mandela became president of South Africa, he appointed a commission to bring to trial those who had been guilty of atrocities during the time of apartheid. This is how it went. Any white officer who voluntarily decided to face his accusers and confess his guilt would not be punished. This happened under Mandela. One day, an aged woman was brought face to face with the officer who had brutally murdered her only son and her husband in front of her eyes. And the court asked her what she wanted from this officer. I know what I'm going to say. You too. This is what the woman said. She said, although I have no family, son and husband gone, I still have a lot of love to give. So she requested that he visit her regularly so she could mother him. Then she said, I would like to embrace him. I want permission from the court to embrace him so he can know that my forgiveness is real and that is not just words.
As the elderly woman made her way to the witness stand, the officer became so overwhelmed with shame and remorse that he fainted. He was visited with the purifying fire of God-given love that can lead to repentance and reconciliation. This woman gave and forgave. And there's a verse in Romans chapter 12 and verse 20 which sheds a lot of light on what I just told you about. There is coming a day, I believe, when we shall understand Romans 12, 19 a bit better. And I would venture to say that maybe that day the officer learned how God's forgiveness frees us from the chains of regret and remorse. Because all of us know that revenge can be attractive. It can be an attractive alternative. It never evens the score. Revenge never evens the score. Forgiveness is the only way to stop the cycle of unfair pain turning in one's memory. To forgive is to set a prisoner free and discover that the prisoner is. Revenge imprisons me, but forgiveness sets me free. The Christian must give place to Jesus when others hurt him, otherwise he will give place to the devil. If he does not, true forgiveness will always elude him. So the statement in St. Luke chapter 17, if you're still with me in your Bibles, the statement of in St. Luke 17, 3 to 5, could be a bit cloudy. Sometimes we read those words and the very wording causes us to bow our heads in despair. Jesus said to his disciples, if your brother or sister sins against you, rebuke them. Even if they sin against you seven times in a day and seven times come back to you saying, I repent, you must forgive them. Now, anybody else talking that, I ain't paying that much money. I have to pay some money because it's Jesus talking. Are you still with me? Yes. Oh, a few of you got distracted just now. That's the teacher thing, is you have to forgive me. So you're back with me, good. Anybody else saying that? I just read some words to you from Jesus in St. Luke 17, 3 to 5. Is it possible to be that forgiving? Not in the flesh. Not in this. Forgiveness operates in the realm of sin when God's standards of Christian behavior are violated. So it does not ignore, deny, or trivialize sin by turning a blind eye. That's what Jesus said. If your brother do something against you, confront him about it and rebuke him. We're talking church here. Not using pious expressions such as time heals all wounds and let bygones be bygones and forgive and forget. By the way, don't forget. I remember you tell me you don't forget. So this is the problem that we have, because every time I look at this finger here, you can't see it, but the top of my finger got cut off when I was a schoolboy. I didn't even know what happened up to there. The scar is still there. The top, and it was hanging on at the side. When I went in, my mother took one look and said, you're too disgusting, you're too hard ears. You ain't standing one here today, you're trying to go down to school. She put it back on the top, stick plaster on, and sent me down to school. I went down to school fuming. And this was my resolve. My mother can't work for a cent. She can't spend a cent at work, you hear me? That has since been resolved. You know, I tell you, it has been resolved. You know, hope nothing. She's in glory now. She gave me that mark there too because it was disgusting. And she threw something and I have that mark for life. But that's been resolved. Thank you, Jesus. You see? We do anything to avoid the offender. anything but face him, anything. But the Bible teaches us how to confront sin properly. The goal or the aim of all confrontation is not to chew up the person and spit them out. I'm talking Christians. But to encourage repentance, restoration, and reconciliation. The Bible calls it gaining my brother by speaking the truth in love, according to Ephesians 4 and 13. You know, I can speak the truth, but not in love. Now look carefully at Matthew chapter 18, another scripture that makes us a little bit uncomfortable. Beginning at 15, the Bible says, if your brother or sister sins, go and point out their fault just between the two of you. Speak directly to the person privately, not on social media. Confront the person humbly and repentantly, not arrogantly and self-righteously. Jesus said on another occasion, he was talking to me, he said, Trevor, how can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, while all the time there is a plank in my own eye? Trevor, you hypocrite. You first have to take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will be able to see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. You're suffering from plankitis. You're only suffering from speckitis. You use the general approach, gentle approach as recommended in Galatians 6 and 1. Paul said, dear brothers, if any believer is overcome by some sin or fault, you who are godly, who are spiritual, should gently and humbly help that person back onto the right path. And be careful not to fall into the same temptation yourself. If you think you are too important to help someone, you are only fooling yourself. You're not that important. That's Galatians 6 and 1 in the Amplified Version. Forgive, I'm into scripture still, keep going with me. Forgive in Luke 17, 3 to 5 has various meanings. It means to set free, it means to release, and in certain contexts, it means to wipe away. Forgiveness is not mere feelings. Anyone can utter sharp words of regret. And to forgive for the moment is not difficult, but can be very uncomfortable when called upon to go on forgiving the same offense every time it resurfaces in the memory, as in the cases of Corrie ten Boom and a guy named Antoine. I can't pronounce his name, but he was from Rwanda. And those of you who are students of current affairs remember Rwanda and the ethnic cleansing that happened down in Rwanda. I remember when 20-something. Almost 100,000 in a matter of less than a month were slaughtered. I had the privilege of sitting with this guy, Antoine from Miranda, in an itinerant evangelist conference they had in Holland. He was one of the main speakers. He got up, he said, brethren, I'm struggling. They killed my family, killed my father. Slaughtered. And God keeps telling me to forgive, and I know to do it. Brethren, he's one of the plenary speakers at that conference. You understand what he's saying? God, if he says, I'm struggling. He reminds me of Don Francisco's song. Lord, you know there seems to be the good and bad, the two of me. One man knows eternity, the other knows the dust. And in the war between the two, the old man rails against the new. My flesh says not to look to you. My spirit knows I must. Lord, I'm glad you are a man and knows the pain and understands the struggle in my soul demands more strength than I possess. Don't let me go. You know, I wonder if I can. Without your help, salvation's more than I can stand. Lord, hear my cry. I'm tired of trying on my own. Standing face to face with truth, I should have known the cross is more than I can carry all alone. Lord, you know that in my mind, I try to see, still I'm blind, living life as you've defined. Please help me understand this place that you have brought me to. to die in order to renew the fires that forge my ties to you. My life is in your hand. We barely trivialize this stuff. Corrie ten Boom, Ravensbrück, Auschwitz, Hitler's madness. Almost her entire family wiped out. They were sent to these places of torture. They were watchmakers in Holland at that time. Corrie's father died. Betsy, her sister, died in imprisonment. And Corrie's heart was turning over with anger and resentment. She wants to do anything to get back at these people. Her sister Betsy kept telling her. My time is almost gone. Her sister Betsy kept telling her, you know, Corrie, you have to love. She said, love these dogs that are so brutal. I want to cut this story short. Through a technical error, when people were being released, because her sister Betsy had said, I had a dream, and Corrie, one of us is going to be released. Both of us are going to be released. She didn't understand the dream because she was released to heaven. She died in prison. That's Betsy, the sister. But Corrie, through a technical error in the books, was released. She should have gone to the gas chamber. If they had been paying attention, Corrie ten Boom should have gone to the gas chamber. But God set it up. So she went, she was released. And when she got outside to freedom, God told her to go around and preach the gospel. He said one day, I want you to go back to Germany. She said, no, Lord, not Germany. Lord, not Germany. Anywhere else. Lord, anywhere else, not Germany. The scenes are too raw. And the moment I step back there, they're going to all resurface. Anyway, she was preaching one day, and at the end, people were in the line waiting to speak to her and, you know, tell her. And as Corrie is standing there, she looks down the line and she sees one of the most brutal officers in that prison coming up the line to greet her. What she does not know is that the Lord has saved him. But all she is seeing is the face of that guy that brutalized prisoners just for sport. Hand them the food and then kick it away. Bring a cup to drink, and when he knocked the cup away and start to laugh. And everything came back flooding in Corrie's mind that day. All of a sudden, she goes limp. All of us, she just come from preaching forgiveness. Look. And when the man stands in front of her, her hands are at her side, she's frozen in position. The man's hand is out like this, Corrie is standing like this. All she sees. Until the man recognized what's happening, and he said, you know, Fräulein, early in the evening, you talked about forgiveness. You know, I was an officer at Ravensbrück, and I regret the things I did. God had mercy on me, and he saved me. Her hand still didn't move. Man's hand is still out there. Her hand didn't move. Until she said, Lord, if you would do something. And the words were out of her mouth until something started happening in her spirit. And they embraced. All she heard the Spirit saying, you have to forgive her. Antoine was the same thing. God sent him a little further. He's preaching to us now. He's telling us. God said, I want you to make a list of all those that you know that brutalized your family and pray for them. I want you to go and visit them one by one. Some of them are in prison. I want you to go and visit them one by one. That is why I made a statement at the beginning of my preaching that God often calls on us to do some difficult things as we press forward on this journey by faith.
As far as I'm aware, God never causes us to do things that are easy. They are always difficult. Forgiveness should be given in proportion to the amount forgiven. How much were you forgiven? Jesus is saying, forgive the brother who sins against you 7 times in a day and comes back saying, I'm sorry. Even though you don't mean it, Jesus says, you are to forgive him. On another scripture, Jesus said, but that one blew me away too. He said, Lord, this can't be for real. That you're telling me that if my brother, now I mean nothing, I just look up and see the sister here. But if my sister has aught against me, Jesus is saying, Trevor, you got to go to her. She ain't to come to you. I don't have that scripture in front of me, but you know that's in your Bible. If your brother has aught against you, she has aught against me. It's not the reverse. Bible is saying, I am to go to her at all. Why do she none?
I can stop now. I know you all want me to stop. So you're up.
Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 to 25 is a classic example of the statement that I just made. Forgiveness should be given in direct proportion to the amount forgiven. And you check it up. How much were you forgiven? It is in that same proportion that you are to forgive. No room is provided for dodging the implication. It is a decision and it is a declaration. Both are involved. Featuring this whole scenario involves a choice. When I say I forgive you with these words, if they are genuine, the issue is dead. When it comes to mind, as every time I look at my finger, the thing of my mother comes to mind. It don't pay me anymore. The scar is there, but it does not pay me. What Jesus is saying is that there comes a time you don't forget. That's what I'm saying. But God has dealt with it in such a way that the pain has gone, even though the scars remain, and you look at that sister as Jesus looks at her. When it comes to mind, as it will, we take it to the Lord. Because only by relying on him can we keep from bringing the offense out in the open again. Remember that forgiveness means to release. Release the desire to get even or the right. Because one of the definitions of forgiveness is giving up my right to hurt you back for hurting me. That's the definition of forgiveness. I give up my right to hurt you back. Because what happens is that the natural thing to do is to hit back. We all hit back. That's why those two T's don't say Jesus can figure him out. As they watched him going up to Calvary, they saw the blood marks all along the way. These two guys, Jesus with his cross on his back, blood drops marked away, a lacerated back. The book of Isaiah says his visage, meaning his face, is an old-time word for face. His visage was marred more than that of any other man. When they hit him, the whip curled around and destroyed this visage, his face. Isaiah saw him and said his visage was marred, mutilated more than that of any other man. And when they saw this, they said, what manner of man is this? What kind of man is this? And furthermore, on the cross, he talking foolishness, but forgive them. All I want is a sword in my hand and downtown Jerusalem 5 minutes, and I'll show you forgive them. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. You see, I can stand up here and preach, but you see, this thing with forgiveness. Debt paid. Brethren, it must also be made clear that true forgiveness cannot be reduced to a simple formula. Because when we take
that forgiveness involves both choice and process. It is unhealthy and unhelpful to internalize my anger or explode it onto others. Nothing will change the past. Try all you want. Refuse to be a prisoner of it. Those who have hurt me in the past will continue to do so as I hold on to the pain by rehearsing it over and over and over in my mind. Pain can be a teacher, so I want to learn from it. As I hear wisdom from Job, this is Job talking in Job chapter 5, verse 2. Certainly, anger kills a stubborn fool, and jealousy murders a gullible person. To worry myself to death with resentment would be a foolish and senseless thing to do. And I have some physician friends who keep telling me, Trevor, if some patients that I have could only learn to forgive, they will cut their medical bills in half. But I can charge them though. Keep coming for the treatment and the bills. They'll pay. Forgive though, and those bills will get cut in half by forgiving the persons that they keep talking to me about. So the scripture that I gave you a while ago, Peter's problem is our problem. Peter comes to the Lord with a problem. You remember what he said? Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me? Calls it sin, and I forgive him. It means that he's talking brother now, this church. This is not your unsaved family member, this brother. So Peter is saying, Lord, I mean, he must have been grappling with it for a while. So when he can't take it no more, he said, look, I better go to Jesus and ask you a question about this thing. He said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? 3 times? So Peter not only comes to the Lord with a problem, he has a proposition to offer as to how it can be solved. We too, we just work it out in our prayer and tell you, Lord, I go in this far. If you meet me halfway, well, but if not, you can't picture this thing. Peter standing in front of Jesus. And when he's finished, he's thinking, well, I've done an excellent job. Because what the rabbis used to teach is that 3 was the limit. 3 was the limit. Peter had talked about 2 or something. Barbarians talk about 1 is a mistake and 2 is for purpose. After 2. I know that. Think, man, I tell you 1 and we think, better don't do it again, because I understand. And I would pick up something and lick you down here, we tell you. And then they come up at Ruby and preach Sunday morning. Treat my wife like a doormat and then come and take communion. Yeah. Saying the big thing. Kneel down and wash the brother's foot, and I got you up in my crawl. Like this. Foot washing, I know if it's out of here. I can kneel down and wash your foot, get up and sit on the side of you and eat your Lord's up and got you up in my crawl. I mean, got you up in my stomach. When Jesus replied, Peter must have been astounded. Jesus said, but Peter, you see what Peter did? Peter doubled the requirement of the rabbis, which was 3, making it 6, and pitched in 1 for good measure. 7 times. 7 times, Lord. I hope you see what you're doing here. I've been reasonable. I'm being generous, Lord. The rabbis taught us that 3 is the limit. After that, an eye for an eye, 2 for 2. Cut off somebody's hand, do something. But I, Lord, you notice that I doubled the requirement of the rabbis and I put in 1 for good measure 7 times. You can imagine how Peter is thinking when Jesus said, but Peter, I don't say unto you 7 times. Now I know we all just sit down there and I know we're going through your mind now. Jesus said 70 times 7. It's worse than that. Jesus is using figurative language there. You know what the implication is? Sometimes I just can't handle it. It means there is to be no counting at all. I know. I see expressions on your faces. I see it again. 70 times 7 is not mathematics. Jesus has gone past mathematics. He's already looking to Calvary. The times I mess up, the besetting sins, and I at the altar every 5 minutes say, Lord, it happened again. Lord, it happened again. Jesus would say, suppose Jesus said, this is the seventh time you back here crawling on all fours like a dog in front of me, talking about forgiveness, and you keep doing things over and over again. This is the last time. Suppose Jesus behaves so, you'll be sitting there here this morning. Because at first I was getting the impression that, you know, look. The long suffering, the patience, the mercy. And Jesus did not die for any sins of his own on Calvary. There's a verse in scripture that says that even before we came here, Jesus died for us. Amen. Jesus died for us. The statement Jesus made in Matthew chapter 18, 22 to Peter and to us this morning cannot be for real. Because this is how I used to interpret it. The Lord is using figurative language. And this thing he's talking about, there has to be some far off ideal that will automatically occur in the sweet by and by, right? But he's talking about a Christianity that goes beyond pious words. It would be foolish to pretend that total forgiveness is not painful. Because my own experience, there was a time when I used to cry so bad when I had to kiss revenge goodbye. I used to cry real bad. I ain't going to get a chance to deal with it, you know. The Apostle Paul one time used an expression, he said, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? He said, I thank God. In the Greek-Roman world, sometimes part of punishment used to be if you kill somebody, they would take the corpse and strap it onto you as part of your punishment. And you would have to carry that corpse along with you until it rotted away of its own accord. That's what he meant when he said, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? He was drawing an illustration that those people understood. Unforgiveness is like that. But we seem to like the smells of it and are comfortable with the rotting. Because when a man can say, over my dead body, sometimes it literally happens. Persons die and they never ask for forgiveness. So careful how we make these comments. I'm not saying that if you are a Christian and you're going to hell, God is going to bring it up at the bema, the judgment seat, and he's going to want to know, but why didn't you forgive? You're going to lose, brethren. Paul said, we all shall appear before the judgment seat of Christ, and our works shall be tried. Not the amount that we did, but the quality of it, of what sort it is. And some of us, the apostles said, are going to suffer loss. because the unforgiveness was not of gold or silver or precious stones or anything, so it was of hay and wood and stubble, and we are going to suffer loss.
I don't want to suffer that kind of loss.
Forgiveness, other than from the heart, is useless. That's how Jesus ended that parable. So if you, Peter, do not forgive from the heart, it's not feeling. Forgiveness is a process. It can be a process. Forgiveness is an act of your will. Forgiveness is not by feeling. If I just tell my wife every 5 minutes, you know, I have a checklist, and the checklist tells me every morning I must tell my wife I love her. So every morning I go and I say, check it off the list. I've done my duty. You feeling good? You know what she didn't do with the flowers and things when I bring them? Them going through the door and I going behind them. Love is not feeling. Same thing goes for prayer. We pray when we feel like it. We pray when we don't feel like it. A preacher said to me one time, Trevor, you got to pray when you don't feel like it, which is often. You got to pray when you feel like it. And you got to pray till you feel like it. Amen. So it is not a matter of feeling. Not love, not forgiveness, not prayer. It's an act of your will. And the prayer things have declined so far now with this COVID thing that it is amazing. But I'm not going there this morning. I have a question for you as I close. But before I ask the question, let me say this. Whatever the issue, forgiveness sets both sides free. It takes the weapon out of Satan's hands and opens the door for God to work in the situation. Forgiveness from the heart should not be too difficult when I bear in mind that God looks beyond my faults and sees my need for forgiveness. It should not be too difficult when I realize that I have hurt others and need their forgiveness. It should not be too difficult when I realize that, Trevor boy, this stress that you carry, your body was not built to carry that stress. You know, your body was not built to carry that stress. The stress that accompanies resentment, ill will, and hatred. I am the first prisoner set free when I forgive. The cycle of blame is broken and the stranglehold of guilt is loosened. True forgiveness deals with evil in a person's heart. So this is the question. Have you ever been able to pray the Lord's Prayer and keep going when you come to that line that we read just now? Knowing that you have not forgiven somebody? The rest is fine. Our Father who art in heaven, bread, and so on and so on and so on. But the line is saying, and forgive me in the same manner that I have forgiven others. That easy. Einstein in the pulpit, no way at all, and telling the congregation that that's easy. Unless the Lord intervenes. Last question. On what grounds can we as believers take up a stubborn stance of unforgiveness and still continue to think that we are maintaining fellowship with God? I'll tell you, it's possible on this ground. If you have never hurt anybody for purpose, or not for purpose, that can happen. So we'll be standing. If you have never hurt anybody, intentionally or unintentionally, you can take up a stubborn stance of unforgiveness and tell God, see, I've never hurt anybody in my whole life. For purpose or not for purpose, I qualify. I want to see.
I'm finished, but I'm going to stop. Those who died yesterday had plans for this morning. Those who died this morning had plans for tonight. Don't take life for granted. Everything can change in the blink of an eye. Here today, thank you. Tomorrow in the equation no more. Here today, so forgive everybody, everything.
We want to thank Evangelist Trevor Francis for that word on forgiveness. It is a timely word. It is not a foreign word. I'm sure you've been hearing sermon on top of sermon about forgiveness. And it is clear that some of us are really not taking it in as we should. If we actually look within ourselves, we can see that there are areas where we're really not obeying. And God takes it upon himself to send us persons who can speak on it, and who can speak on it from a depth that we really need to hear forgiveness on. Because we've been hearing it often, and some of us are really not taking it in. The word says that if you see you hate your brother, how can you love God and you hate your brother? It is in the word. Okay? So I really want to take this time to tell persons to, you know, don't let us be Sunday Christians. If we come, we hear the word, we feel good, we understand what is being said. And then from the time we hit the door and the wind outside just seems to blow everything off of us until the following Sunday, in some cases. So we really want to thank Evangelist Francis for his timely word. Most of us as children of God knows very well what he said, and we know how it is we are supposed to live. It is not easy, but the Lord says that his strength is made perfect in our weakness. We are supposed to turn to him. Okay, when in difficult times. We know what it is we are supposed to do, but we are not supposed to do it on our own steam. We must rely on the Holy Spirit and on God to do these things. And once we turn to him, and we call out to him, and we try to live our lives, I didn't say try because we will err, but once we try to live our lives according to his will, yeah, he will continue to forgive us as we should continue to forgive each other. Amen. Amen. At this time, the notices, I believe Minister Curtin has a notice. Before he comes, the usual notices, Bible study 6 and 7:30 on Tuesday evenings. I want us to continue to pray as we would have prayed for Brother Orson, continue to pray for R. Clyde, Sister Phyllis, all those elders who may not have any infirmities, but we haven't seen them for a while. We pray that God will continue to keep them, and that they will sometime soon be able to join us here in the sanctuary as we continue to give thanks and praise to Almighty God. At this time, I'll let Minister Curtin come and make his announcement before we close.
Thank you, Brother Howard. I just want to make this announcement on behalf from the pastor. Baptism will be held the last Saturday of this month. This will make it the 28th. Next Sunday, the 29th, Saturday, the 28th at the Miami Beach 9 o'clock. So we are inviting you, as usual, to be a part of that baptism ceremony. Brother John, he was just here a moment ago.
Yes.
Brother Matthew has a problem, and we're going to pray with him. I ask you to indulge us for a few minutes. Brother John is going to pray for him and the family, the troubles that he's having. We know that God is a promise keeper and a prayer answering God. So tarry with us for just a few moments.
Good morning to the church. I think a lot of you might know that within the last maybe 5 or 6 years, Brother Matthew and his family have gone through the loss of a couple family members, and you were sharing with me in the last couple of weeks that there's one family member who has been going through medical issues for the last 12 years, and now that family member is hospitalized, and in his words, you don't know when it will be the last time. So this morning, I just want to ask you to join with me and Brother Matthew. He's the representative of the family. And if those of you in the congregation, as I pray, you know the prayer, just remember Matthew's family. Remember his mother especially, because she's a sister of this one that is ill. So I want you to join with me as I commit Matthew and his family to the Lord. Let's stand, and if you want, you can stretch your hand out to Brother Matthew as we pray for him. Our Father and our God, we thank you this morning that you are our God. You are our Lord. You are our Savior. You are our healer. You are our provider, Lord. You are our great physician. And Father, you've told us in your word that we can cast all our cares upon you, Lord, because you care for us. And Father, this morning we recognize that you are here with us, and you are hearing our heart's cry and the heart's cry of those who cry out to you, Father, in a sincere way. And this morning we lift Brother Matthew before you. We bring his family before you, Lord. Father, you know that they have been going through, Lord, trying times. Times of sickness, Lord, and even times of death, Lord, they have experienced, Lord. And our brother, Lord, has requested, Lord, that we as a church family lift him and his family up to you, Lord. Father, we do so right now, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And we ask you, O God, you will minister to them at this very time. Have them to know that someone, somewhere, some persons, Lord, are praying for them. They may feel that power in their soul and in their hearts, knowing that we indeed are standing in a gap for them, Lord Jesus. Father, lift his family who's in hospital before you, Lord. Father, only you know the exact condition that she's in, Lord. Father, only you know if she would pass away or would continue, Lord, for maybe days, maybe months, maybe years, Father. We want to ask you in the name of Jesus, and according to your will, that you would indeed touch her, Lord, even now. Father, I pray that if she does not know you as Lord and Savior, Lord, I pray that something, some word might be said, Lord, that she might cry out to you and ask your forgiveness so that she can spend eternity with you, Lord. Not only pray for her, Lord, we want to pray for any other members of Matthew's family who might not know you as Lord and Savior. I pray, God, this morning that they might cry out to you and come to know you, who to know is life eternal. So, Father, again, we want to commit our brother Matthew before you, Lord. He is part of our family here at Ruby. We pray, Lord, that he might feel your presence even now, and he might know that he's loved and he's supported in this time of need, time of sickness. So we bless your name this morning. Thank you for all you've done already this morning. Thank you for all you're going to do. And I pray that in all we do and say, you might get all the glory, all the honor, and all praise. Father, we give you thanks in that name, that wonderful name, the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Amen.
Yes, church, let us continue to pray for each other and each other's households. And as we go down through the week, I want you to take in the message that was given. And I want you to realize there are three spirits that we really want to rid ourselves of. An unforgiving spirit, an unrepentant spirit, and an unteachable spirit. We need to rid ourselves of those, okay? And that is a good place to start. I'm sure there are other things too. Because we are filthy rags, really and truly, made clean only by the blood of the Lord Jesus. So there are lots of things that we need to as the prophet would always say, take an introspection and look to God for guidance, for direction, not on our own steam. Okay, do we have any birthdays? Celebrating birthdays and anniversaries today. I know Brother Braff, Brother Kenneth, we always tell him Brother Braff, Raffy. Brother Kenneth, his birthday was yesterday. His lovely wife, Sister Diane, her birthday is today. All of my August people, there's some others, I saw some other hands just now. Oh, Sister Ward at Waterman. Oh, sorry, the mask has me a little bit sometimes, yes. Sister Waterman, Brother Ivan. I'm celebrating the birthday as well. Sister Charlene. Sister Mark. Pardon me? Brother Waterman. Oh, I need a list. Yeah, Sister Charlene. I mentioned Sister Charlene as well. Yeah, all my good August people. Sister Marlene and Sister Marlene as well. And I want to take this time out to Sister Marcy as well. Wow. Oh, Cassandra. Oh, okay, Sister Cassandra. All right, so we have a lot of August folks here in Ruby Church, and I want to take this time out to wish you all the best during the week. May you have an enjoyable birthday and even beyond, but I pray that it is a special time for you. So before the worship team sings our closeout song, we'll have our benediction. And may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, rest and abide with us now and forevermore. Amen. In the words of my good friend, Brother Koji, go in peace and continue to praise the Lord.